Can I ask you a question? What phone do you have? How long have you had it? Not like that phone specifically, but how long have you had that kind of phone? Maybe it's a Samsung or an iPhone or even a Pixel. Was the last one you had also a Samsung, iPhone, or Pixel as well? How about the one before that? When was the last time you switched anyway? Does anyone even switch anymore? If not, why not? And is that a bad thing? Okay, so that's actually quite a few questions, but I've just spent a month with my favorite new phone in years, and I just can't bring myself to keep it. And I hate that. So let's explore this. I'm Chris DeGraw for Digital Trends, and we're about to get a little nitty and a little gritty. Over the last 10 to 15 years, as smartphones have largely finished saturating the market, consumers seemed to have finished nestling into the spaces in which they feel the most comfortable. And it didn't take as long as you might think. Let's dig into the data and ask ourselves what the implications of this kind of stubbornness may or may not be on you, on the market, and on innovation as a whole. The numbers I'm about to reference come from a site called StatCounter. It's a tool you can use as well to access any of this information and much more. Essentially, they track which devices, operating systems, browsers, all that kind of stuff that people are using on the web. And while it's neither comprehensive nor definitive, I think it's a great baseline for helping illustrate the way things are cut up during any given year. Speaking globally first, iOS has floated between about 20 and 27% market share since 2011. As for Android, ignoring specific OEMs for the moment, they've had a steadier climb, ultimately reaching around 70 to 75% global market share by 2017 and hovering right around there since. Obviously, this data is gonna vary wildly depending on if you're looking at the global breakdown versus the US specifically or any other country specifically for that matter, but what doesn't seem to change is that consistency over time. Let's break it down further and take a look at specific devices. The iPhone's slice has held stable at just over 50% in the US for closing in on a decade now. Okay, so what, you might be saying. Everyone knows, once you're inside Apple's walled garden, it's like Hotel California. You can check in anytime you want, but you can never leave. And sure, yeah, there's absolutely truth to that. You might say then, but there are a ton of Android manufacturers, which there aren't really a ton anymore, there are like four. But surely at least some folks are perfectly comfortable bouncing between each year to year, depending on the current offerings. And again, sure, some maybe, but according to the data, not very many. Since 2015, Samsung has owned approximately 30% of US market share, give or take a few percentage points. And as for the rest, well, they're hardly worth even mentioning it, but let's mention them a bit for posterity's sake. The late great LG peaked at just over 4% worldwide in 2016. May they rest in peace. And since then, the most popular non-Samsung Android OEMs have been, consistently, Huawei, Xiaomi, and Oppo. Each fighting a battle in another part of the world for about 5 to 10% global market share each. The remaining names that you're probably more familiar with, the likes of Motorola or Sony, for example, Lenovo even, well, let's just say they should keep their day jobs. Before moving on, I want to recognize that these percentage windows do account for probably hundreds of thousands, if not literally millions of people, which is no small number. Of course, they matter a great deal to the manufacturers themselves, more so even to their shareholders. But to you or me, they don't mean a whole lot, and they paint a very clear picture, which is that people know what they like, and what they don't like is change. Yet every year, we see the same videos over and over. Will you ditch Samsung for the iPhone's best-in-class camera? I switched from iOS to Android. Is this interesting content? We see the same article headlines over and over too. Will Samsung's X feature finally convince users to switch from iPhone? Or more recently, will the David Pixel 6 and 6 Pro with their fancy new Tensor chips and killer cameras be enough to position Google to take on the Goliath Samsung? Spoiler alert, the answer to every one of those questions is no. Sure, the needle will move, as it always does, a percentage point or two either way, and that's a lot, as I've mentioned. In the case of my new bestie, the Pixel 6, probably at least enough to satisfy stakeholders and keep alive the long-aspired dream of a purely Google device that rivals the very best. But that's about as far as it goes. You or me, the enthusiasts, we may be enticed by innovative new features, nerdy new SoCs, or even just the feeling of something slightly fresh or slightly different. But for people who just need a phone that works in all the most important ways for their day-to-day lives, it's gonna take a lot more convincing, unfathomable marketing dollars, established brand recognition, an undeniable population of loyalist customers, and great reviews from both industry professionals and one's own network of family and friends dropping little nuggets of gadget envy over a period of years before they risk switching things up and taking on what is considered by many to be a huge learning curve, even between two devices that are, on their surface, quite similar, like a Galaxy and a Pixel, never mind Android versus iOS. Which begs the question, will this ever change? Can it ever change? Well, before that, I want to insist that on an individual level, switching phones or operating systems is neither good nor bad. Of course, everyone should feel perfectly comfortable and unashamed for using what they like and what's within their budget. There's no device, platform, or morality judgment here. But the more people who are willing to try different devices, the more competition there will theoretically be, which does benefit everyone. So what will it take then to make switching phones easier? Or, put another way, make the decision of which phone to buy even remotely as difficult as it used to be? Well, government regulation could be one option, by forcing companies to share technologies like opening up iMessage to other platforms, for example, or standardizing software and security update requirements across the industry. But of course, not everyone appreciates government intervention, and there's good reason to worry that that might just stifle innovation too. Another way to potentially challenge the status quo might be if a company releases a groundbreaking new feature that enough people can't live without that they're forced to dip their toes into new waters. Though that seems increasingly unlikely, and even if it were to happen, the new thing would probably just be quickly copied by all the major players anyway. The growing popularity of a system on a chip is one example of that. Folding phone tech, another that comes to mind. Samsung wasn't the first to release a commercially available folding phone, but their deep pockets and penchant for trying new things allowed them to quickly find themselves among the best. And let's face it, with the market they hold already, they don't stand to lose as much as less well-known brands. And no matter what strong opinions you might see on Twitter, you can bet if they keep perfecting that technology and enough people are buying it, Apple's hands will be forced as well in order to ensure that their customers aren't tempted to look elsewhere. Perhaps I'm just a cynic, but the battle royale started well over a decade ago now, and frankly, I think we have our victors. Big companies don't just loosen their grip voluntarily or otherwise, even when something terrible happens, like a major flop. The infamous Note 7 debacle, which feels like an eternity ago, had as many as 112 devices catching fire in the first month of release alone, prompting them to recall the phone and fix it, only for it to happen again after re-release, resulting in a second recall. It's all anyone in the tech space was talking about for half a year at least, and yet it made no difference to their overall market share. I don't mean it barely made a dent, I mean it wasn't even a blip, according to StatCounter. If Note 7 buyers switched phones, it was primarily to other Samsung phones. Now that is loyalty. And so I'm left with two questions that I want to hear your answers to. First of all, does it even matter? Either on an individual level or in the grand scheme of things, do you believe that people's general obstinance with regard to their smartphone of choice is an issue at all? Is there any measurable effect on competition or innovation, or is all of this much ado about nothing? And secondly, presuming I've convinced you of at least the possibility that there is an effect or that it is a problem, is there any way out? Can these lines I've been showing you ever move, like really move, in any meaningful capacity? Or is the race already over and just like other massive names in tech today, like Amazon, Facebook, even Tesla, are they so weaved and wedged into our society that no bright-eyed startup could even dream of becoming more than a pesky mosquito swiftly swapped by the hands of giants? I don't know the answer to either of those questions. My love affair with the Pixel 6 Pro is the primary reason that this has been on my mind in the first place. I am an Apple user and have been now for some 5 or 6 years, and I very much reap the benefits of that ecosystem. But this phone is so nice that I can't help but wonder what else it would even need to do to get me or someone like me to switch. Now, I really look forward to hearing your thoughts on this one, but that's gonna do it for me today. You know what to do if you want more content. All the buttons are within your reach. I encourage you to tap them. I've been Chris DeGroff for Digital Trends, and I hope to see you soon.